What's going on, guys? This is Rob. If you guys enjoy my content, make sure you hit the subscribe button and make sure you hit that little bell so you never miss out on my sexy voice. Okay, so we are jumping back into Batman the White Knight. And here's the deal. So with the camera, I like having the camera and doing FaceTime when I'm like explaining ideas. But with stories, I don't really see a reason to change that. I don't really see a reason to change the format that we currently have at the moment. I think it's kind of cool because it allows the emphasis to be on what we're talking about so much as me just like explaining things. So with Batman the White Knight, this is cool because what the story does, and this is one of the reasons why Sean Murphy's writing is so interesting, is it seems to follow like the traditional standard of storytelling to a point. In the sense that we basically have like a set of circumstances we're familiar with, right? Like the first third of the story basically opened up, or really, yeah, I guess the first third so far opened up with like, here's how Gotham City works. That's basically Batman as you're used to him. The Joker's a bad guy. Batman's chasing him around, so on and so forth. Pretty straightforward. And then suddenly it's the shift. And it's, well, Joker then becomes sane and he becomes a good guy. And so the whole idea here had basically been, how does Joker as a good guy, as Jack Napier, present this scenario that Batman is actually more of a hindrance for Gotham City than a benefit? And that's when he started rolling into things like the Batman Devastation Fund, the idea that when Batman went into a neighborhood and things went awry, that the property values of the neighborhood would absolutely plummet. The wealthy would go in and buy up all the property. They would wait for the Gotham City government to use the Devastation Fund or the Emergency Fund to basically fix everything. And then when the property values went back up, the wealthy would sell them. Because of that, like with all these different things going on, the overall gist of this is that Jack Napier has put out the narrative that while Batman doesn't know it, he's basically an enforcer for the wealthy against the poor. And it's so cool because Bruce had no idea what was going on. And the picture that had been painted by Jack Napier was like, it doesn't matter if he doesn't know. That's the way it is. What you think is going on is irrelevant in the face of what's actually going on. And so the whole basis behind this was for Jack Napier to basically say, the only way for Gotham City to actually become the city that it wants to become this beacon of what Batman is shooting for, this beacon of hope and light, much like Metropolis, is for Gotham City to do it on its own. It's for Gotham City to cast off Batman. Because for everyone out there who looks at Gotham City as a potential place to live, what they'll always say is, well, what happens when Batman stops being Batman? What happens when he dies or he retires or whatever the case may be? What happens when Batman ceases to exist? Then what happens to Gotham? And I'm not moving my family to a town that's going to go to pieces as soon as Batman's killed or something along those lines. No one sees it as like a viable opportunity for like the long term. And so that's the basis of Jack Napier, is to say like, we can revamp the city and make it our own. The issue with this is that Batman is still on the fringe and Batman's still operating under the idea that while Jack Napier is popping pills and he's basically sane now, keeping the Joker persona completely curved and in the background, the time will come when he will become the Joker again. In Batman's eyes, it's only a matter of time. Where Batman had kind of jumped in and basically stopped the Gotham City Police Department and, you know, Nightwing and Batgirl from capturing Neo Joker and the Mad Hatter, while it wasn't his intention to like allow those villains to go, his actions resulted in them going away. And so what this has done is it's put Batman in a position to where Nightwing and Barbara Gordon are somewhat siding against him. Now, Barbara Gordon is still kind of walking the middle ground here. Nightwing is on Batman's side in so far that when the argument's made, like Batman needs to be rounded up and then we'll unmask him so everybody knows who he really is. They'll know that we caught him legitimately. Nightwing's stance is no. You know, we bring Batman in, but at the end of the day, he keeps his mask. And it's kind of cool because it's still really Nightwing's attachment to like the legacy of Batman, keeping that aspect of himself private. And so initially, like with Barbara Gordon, again, she's on the fence here, right? Like Barbara Gordon's stance is like, look, we owe Bruce Wayne. Now, in truth, in this story, we're basically given the notion that like the killing joke happened. Barbara Gordon was shot, she was paralyzed, she was Oracle, and now she's where she is now. We are given those little tidbits here and there. But for Barbara Gordon, it seems to go much deeper than the fact that like she was shot by the Joker once and, you know, eventually came back to health and, you know, she was Batgirl and all that kind of cool stuff. It's loyalty is what this is. Loyalty to the ideology of what Batman stands for and what Gotham City needs. It's the ideology of what Batman stands for that makes all this so significant. And so with that in mind, like ultimately she just kind of walks out and says, look, if you guys are going to do this, I cannot be a party to this whole situation. And so ultimately what you end up having is you have Jack Napier and you have everybody else kind of rounding up and then suddenly coming up with ideas or trying to figure out ideas on how to take out Batman, because the guy is quite literally a one-man army. The various tools he has at his disposal, the various forms of travel, they're military grade. A person with a sniper rifle on a building is not going to be able to kill Batman by shooting him through the glass in the front window of the Batmobile. It wasn't designed for that purpose. The one thing that it can't deflect is an EMP because it has electronic components. It needs those things. The reason why nobody ever thought thought about using an EMP before is because of collateral damage. They would not only take out the Batmobile, they would take out like whatever vehicles were chasing after him, and they would take out power within like, you know, a 6-block radius. And with Batman having his resources at his disposal, even if they took down the Batmobile, Batman would be able to make his escape, and then they'd be no better off than they were before. And the city of Gotham would hate them because they've taken down power to a portion of the city. And so they come up with this really, really genius idea. Nightwing basically steals this old analog style Batmobile that didn't really run on the same level of electronics that the current version does. If I remember correctly, this is a throwback to Batman the Animated Series, which I kind of like about this. It's pretty cool, and it's pretty interesting to see. But what they end up doing is they basically like chase him into a warehouse, and then suddenly they just like blank on all these lights, which of course blinds Batman, and then they detonate this EMP. And the idea is that because the warehouse is lined with lead, the EMP will only affect Batman's Batmobile. It won't affect anything else around the city. And with the older version of the Batmobile that Jim Gordon's driving, running, you know, basically an analog vehicle without all the other digital components that currently exist in the newest version, his vehicle will run along just as well as anybody else's. And that's what happens. What ends up going on here is Batman is of course, you know, blinded and taken by surprise with the whole thing. Jim Gordon fishtails Batman, swerves under him, and sends him flying into a pole. And where Batman initially makes his escape from Jim Gordon, he's met by the arrival of Jack Napier. And this is awesome. This is probably one of the coolest moments in the whole story, because this is like the fight scene from like They Live, right? Like Rowdy Roddy Piper versus that one black dude who does the narrations for the Navy. It's just a bare knuckle fight between Jack Napier and Batman. And under normal circumstances, we would expect Jack Napier to basically have his backside handed to him quite readily by the Dark Knight. But remember, Jack Napier has been training here. Now, this is where I kind of think that Sean Murphy fudges the numbers a bit. Batman is the culmination of like decades of martial arts training. Jack Napier doesn't have anywhere near that level of training. Now, an argument could be made that like Jack Napier was able to capitalize on Batman being injured. It's really the only reason why. Batman was in a weakened state, so on and so forth. But we have to believe that with all the battles that Batman's fought over the course of his existence as a superhero, all the life-threatening injuries he sustained, all the times that he pushed himself to the limit and kept on going, that he would be able to overcome this. But that's the beauty of this story being a miniseries that's not in continuity. Basically, it's Sean Murphy telling us everything else you know, throw it away, like throw it out. And the fight between the two of them is hardcore. This fight is the culmination of just like years and decades of Batman chasing after the Joker. So these guys are fighting with their heart and soul. Every ounce of anger, every ounce of vitriol, every ounce of hate being poured into this physical battle. The issue with this is that Batman's injuries get the better of him and Jack Napier comes out on top. And so what we end up doing is having Jack Napier basically take the body of Bruce Wayne directly back to Commissioner Gordon, everybody, and they end up throwing him into Arkham Asylum and essentially intending to leave him there. The issue with this is that before any of this can basically happen, we end up having like this giant gun that was used by Neo Joker, this giant freeze gun that's fired on the city of Gotham. And what she does is right into the side of several buildings, send the Joker. Now, this is where things get really, really interesting. And this is actually where I think Sean Murphy goes a totally different direction, but it all sort of ties everything in together. Victor Freeze, for the most part in the story, was just a guy who's there. And in the early issues, the question that had to be asked was, why is he here? What this does is it basically says like that his father was part of the Axis powers, that Thomas Wayne was part of the Allied powers. And the two of them basically crossed paths when Thomas Wayne learned of the cryogenics research that was being performed by the father of Victor Freeze. And where the US military industrial complex wanted to use the father of Victor Freeze's research for weapons use, Thomas Wayne wanted to use it for a source of healing. And Victor Freeze agreed with this idea, using those things to make the world a better place. And so because of this, Victor Freeze is just kind of a guy who operated in the background and seems to have like a long-standing relationship with the Waynes insofar that he goes all the way back to Thomas. And where he spilled all this information to Bruce, he's spilling all the information to Barbara Gordon right now. The other half of this is that the way that Victor Freeze found out the identity of Bruce Wayne was that when Bruce Wayne was initially injured at the beginning of the story and then showed up back, and then Alfred basically, you know, Bruce Wayne woke up and Alfred was in a chair dead and Bruce Wayne was hooked up to the freeze technology, which had kept him alive. What we end up finding out is Victor Freeze was there. That Alfred essentially called him and said, like, you have to come here, you have to help out, you have to get Bruce Wayne back on his feet. Alfred sacrificed his life for that purpose. But the promise that Victor made at the behest of a dying man was, you cannot tell anybody the identity of Bruce Wayne. I'm not making this request because I somehow have the ability to enforce it. I'm making this request because you're an honorable man and I know that you will honor it. Victor Freeze goes through, talked about his father, you know, Baron von Freeze. He despised what his father stood for. He despised what his father was about. And that's why all this is being done. Now, the biggest downside of this, and the reason why this is so cool, is because Barbara Gordon showed up here looking for answers, finding a way to like deactivate this freeze gun. Victor Freeze's response is, my father built it. I don't know anything about it. I can't deactivate this thing for you. I can't undo this. You're going to have to find a different way. And so ultimately she just ends up leaving no better off than she was when she first got here. And so what we do is we pick back up with Jack Napier. And again, this is where the whole argument kind of comes to fruition in the sense that like Jack Napier's lost control of everything. Jack Napier took the quick and easy path. He just kind of walked into the situation that in his hubris and in his arrogance of believing he could conquer the city of Gotham, what he didn't take into account is all the wild cards, characters like Neo Joker and collateral damage. And it's like, that's the one thing Batman always realized, that sure, you can move this chess piece here, but if you do, somebody else is going to move their chess piece there. It's not a game that's played where there's no consequence. And this is kind of Sean Murphy throwing into our faces this idea that Batman walks a knife's edge, that every single time Bruce Wayne dons the cape and cowl, and every single time he goes out into the city of Gotham as Batman, he has to weigh the pros and cons of every decision he makes. And while Bruce Wayne's intelligence allows him to do that, Jack Napier is a guy who's popping pills to keep the Joker persona at bay. He is not Bruce Wayne. And so this is cool, because essentially the argument by Harley Quinn is, you've totally lost control of the situation. Like, you've spent so much time trying to develop the Gotham anti-terrorist group. You've spent so much time trying to sit down and try to be Bruce Wayne. You never took the time to realize that you cannot be Bruce Wayne, because you are not Bruce Wayne, and you cannot function in the same capacity as Batman. What ends up happening is you basically have Jack Napier, who essentially gives in. He goes and he meets with everybody, with the Gotham City Police, with the vigilantes, with everyone here. And the question's asked, what do we do? She's demanding the Joker. What option do we have? And Jack Napier's response is, there's only one option that we have. And he essentially allows his Joker persona to cut loose, and we end up seeing the return of the Joker. With that being said, guys, we're going to bring this video to an end. If you are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the sub button to become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys enjoyed this video, make sure you drop a like, and I will catch you all later. Peace.